Combat is combat, no matter what form it takes. Whether two fighters square off in the ring, or two armies meet in the battlefield, the objective is one: defeat the enemy. But how deep does this correlation run? Can an individual fighter learn from the battles of collective units the same way a general can learn from the bouts of a singular combatant? In order to begin exploring this inquiry, let us first examine one of the key components of battle, the chaotic dimension of time. Though the time frame between the two modes of combat differs vastly, their effective time frames are actually very similar. In small-scale battle, time is extremely limited. Split-second decisions must be made at an instant's notice. In fact, most adjustments are not made by reaction, but rather by anticipation, for only within longer distances can one truly react to their opponent's motions. In large-scale clashes, the overall battle may run longer, but one cannot move a unit of 1,000 men as quickly as a single person can swing a fist. If they are to react to their enemy's advancement, they must do so almost instantly, or in fact, even preemptively. For by the time their command is heard and executed, the damage may already be dealt. Therefore, any decision made, both in hand-to-hand combat and large-scale battle, carries an inherent risk, which is why anticipation is a fundamental element that makes both intelligent fighters and great generals. Each unit of an army needs to function in a specific manner, what is commonly portrayed in film, where two masses clash against each other indiscriminately, while the two opposing heroic figures slash down enemies with the power of the film's script, is unsurprisingly far from realistic. Each unit must have a specific predetermined function based on their weaponry, for this will also determine their potential mobility, attack range, and overall utility. In other words, for the general, a unit is the weapons that they use. Scaling down, this principle is similar to a single person executing a strike. These are maneuvers that are honed and repeated to the point of becoming instinctual, like a well-trained military unit. A jab, for example, is mainly used to keep the opponent at a safe distance, hinder their advancements, and inflict damage, similar to the light infantry. Each person within a specific military unit must also work in accordance with their fellow soldiers, for if the men in a formation do not work as one, then they will not be functional. Each strike must be synchronized, and each defensive maneuver must be done in unison. Similarly, when a strike or defensive motion is made, it requires coordinated movement from several sections of the human body. If one throws a punch with just their arm, it will be weak and ineffective. However, if they twist their hips and shoulders and transfer their weight into the punch, then this strike will become devastating. Having advantage in weaponry for an army is similar to having advantage in technique in hand-to-hand combat. It is not an absolute deciding factor in either type of battle, yet can be a significant advantage if all else is equal. An advantage that can tip the scales of battle. Other than the weapons each unit holds, another deciding factor to their efficacy is their armor. Heavily armored units can sustain more punishment from the opposing army with little to no harm, but will typically lack in mobility, visibility due to the cumbersome helmets, and even striking force. On the other hand, lightly armored units are far more vulnerable to inflictions, yet have increased mobility for evasion and can strike at varying distances. Of course, if one is to evade opposing attacks, rather than absorbing the strike via the use of armor, then they must be capable of anticipating said attacks, or have enough room to be able to react. If they fail to anticipate or lack the required distance to react, then they will surely be decimated. Similarly, when holding up one's arms in order to block an incoming barrage of strikes, the damage is significantly limited, but visibility and striking potential are reduced, and one can be rendered immobile to a certain degree. Conversely, If one wishes to parry a strike with a single hand, or dodge it altogether, then they must either have anticipated the strike, or have enough room to react to it. Preemptively holding a hand up while striking is a principle widely used in martial arts, for it allows for a level of defense even while being on the offensive. This is very similar to the use of a shield, which would provide protection in both aspects of combat, offensive and defensive. The overall size of an army will not always equate to its effective power. If an army is large but the units within it are undisciplined and lacking the proper guidance from their general, then the chances of them failing to a smaller, more disciplined force increase exponentially. Also, maneuvering a large army is difficult, and if the general is not strategically competent, then they are more easily swayed into creating openings for the opposing army to strike where they are the weakest, their commanders. This is very much similar to the mass or physical strength of an individual fighter. If they are unkempt or untrained, they will not fare well against a smaller, well-trained individual. Additionally, larger opponents may also lack the same level of speed and mobility of smaller individuals, which can lead to them being stricken from angles which they did not anticipate. A prime example of this is Mike Tyson's domination of the heavyweight category in boxing, or even Geo Martinez's victory against Haysam Rida in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. There are also many examples to draw upon in historic military battles, like the Battle of Gaugamela, where Alexander the Great demolished a much larger army, that led by Darius III. Of course, all else being equal, the larger army will carry an advantage over their adversary. Now, the most important aspect of both the fighter and the army is the mind behind their actions. The commander can be equated to an individual's fight IQ, as it is many times called, though he is not merely that. The general makes decisions both on and off the battlefield, as his directions echo throughout every aspect of the life of his soldiers. How they eat, how they train, and how they are rewarded are all facets that must be accounted for by their leader, similar to a single person's mind. To be more specific, the leader must account for, first, the proper technique honed by a repetition and experience. Second, proper bodily exercise and conditioning for battle. Third, tactical and strategic superiority. And fourth, emotional and mental calmness before and during the battle. A well-balanced army works as a single unit, like a colony of ants that collectively work similar to the neurons of a brain. 10,000 soldiers are but one collective mind. Accordingly, they must be disciplined, for otherwise, in the heat of battle, they may simply give up and abandon. A general must punish or rid the army of dissent, while rewarding loyalty and courage. An individual, too, must be disciplined, not only prior to battle, like during their training, but also throughout the fight itself. If one specific unit begins to dissent, like for example if a cavalry unit does not follow an order to strike, or retreats when uncalled for due to fear of incurring damage, it is similar to how a single combatant can be conditioned by their opponent to avoid striking due to fear. Indeed, one may want to strike, but before the movement can be executed, they can already feel the pain from the retaliation which is yet to manifest. This resulting hesitation will leave one prone to overreact to feints, or give up when the fight takes a difficult turn. One needs synergy between the general and the army, or the mind and the body, in order to act optimally in any possible situation. It must be mentioned that other factors, like the battlefield where the fight takes place, or the number of armies involved, are also important. Battles can be fought in mountainous areas, wooded forests, or even across rivers. Similarly, fights won't always take place in the relative safety of a protected ring or tatami. Obstacles in the environment, high and low ground, or the rigidity of the surface on which fighters stand, as well as any potential reinforcements, are all factors that should be considered prior or during a violent engagement. This comparison between large-scale and small-scale battles has existed arguably since the Homeric times, and surely since the classical era of Greece. The Athenian general Iphicrates, a colossal figure of both strategy and leadership, one whose reforms revolutionized ancient Hellenic warfare and paved the way for the success of Alexander the Great's conquest of the East, was a brilliant strategist and military tactician who was victorious all over the ancient Hellenic world. Not only that, but Iphicrates is one of a few surviving sources that would specifically mention and even particularly name how each unit of an army translates to an individual's bodily aspect. An honorable mention must also be made to Miyamoto Musashi, the brilliant Japanese strategist who would also address this concept in his book, Gorin no Sho, the Book of Five Rings. It is there where he stated, "The way of battles is the same for man-to-man fights as for 10,000-a-side battles." As this YouTube channel hopefully grows with the passage of time, we intend to study particular historic battles and directly translate them into hand-to-hand combat, displaying them in a choreographed, animated, or live-action fight scene. Of course, this can only be done with your support. If you would like to share this video to others you believe might be interested, or even honor us with a contribution via the links in the description below, any means of growth for the channel are a step forward in the struggle to revive the lost art of Pankration.